Less serious topic, which is a general character. The problem of the actual theoretical limits, which is based on the exponent typical, is the standard model, is based on a number of pillars, which is which are the interaction symmetry and Lorentz invariance. However, these topics are typically discussed, and there is no consensus, no general consensus about all these arguments. And many physicists are searching for a new formulation of theoretical physics, able to overcome this struggle, which includes all theoretical physicists, in order to generalize theoretical physics, if possible, in order to deal not only with nuclear physics, particle physics, and so on, but in order to deal with complex phenomena, the mind, the brain, and the consciousness, and so on. Yet physics deals with economics, for instance, at this moment, but this is not enough. We need a general, more general physics which deal with all kind of phenomena, not only the one dealing with traditional physics. This is the age of traditional theoretical physics, which is a temple based on some pillars which traditional fixed, invariable, and so on. And all physicists studying the university, they learn to work, which is kind of pillars. However, I must begin by remarking that this image of physics is based on some derivation from the old Newtonian dream. It's not the Democritus dream like here, because we don't know whether Democritus were aware of this picture of this of the things. But according to the Newtonian dream, the world is based on a population of units which are indivisible, and they are typically they have the vertical or south force. And each one is interact with other particles, and all the universe is here. There is nothing else there is in the universe. What are these units? We don't know. They cannot be studied inside. So our knowledge stops here. And it's possible to go on. And this dream was reinforced many years after by Lorentz. Typically, the world imagined by Lorentz, one of the founders of the relativity theory, induced most people to feel that this dream is the correct dream. And so, when we study in the university, we learn that there are the sources of the fields, and after there are the interaction. But without sources, it is impossible to have interaction of any kind. And all the physical treaties are based on this vision. Why to change? Why physics should change? The main problem is the existence of a complexity, because this vision don't take into account the complexity. In traditional physics, this only with very simple phenomena, it is impossible to understand what is the complexity. And the complexity is of many different kinds. One kind of complexity is based on the fact that we have complex phenomena. And another kind of complexity is derives from the fact that we are very different and complex and complicated also kind of measure. Another kind of complexity arises from the fact that we have different goals. And another, of course, is based on the fact that we have a number of different theories which are typically complex. I don't spend much time to speak about the complexity of phenomena, which is common for all people, for all physicists. Not only in astroparticle physics, of course, in which, however, it is impossible to understand what happens actually, not only in LHC, but also in the space telescope and so on. In condensed matter physics, the number of phenomena is so great that it's impossible to have a unique theory understanding in order to understand what happens. There are so many phenomena. I don't speak about econophysics, which speaks about emergence, so impossible. And biophysics? Biophysics is not the theory of biological matter. We must not forget that the biological matter includes ourselves. So we must speak about brain, not only about the brain, but about the mental processes which take their origin in the brain. And we must speak about consciousness, which is a byproduct of our brain, in a sense, of our body. The measure half can be unreliable, typically. The situation is so complex that practically the world of all measure kinds is impossible to understand by the majority of physicists. Any physicist know only a little bit of this enormous situation. Not only there are many conceptual problems. Why? Because can you think that it is reliable to take the measure through a computer like in Geneva? There is no way which is controlling. There are no bubble chambers in which one looks. So, and you are confident in this kind of measure. In space telescopes, there is a machine which looking and controlling the data also. What happens? In the case of biological matter, if you look at biological matter, any measure can produce a perturbation, and the perturbation changes the biological matter. What is the biological matter before the perturbation? Oh, we don't know, it is impossible to understand. And in social psychological research, only my presence here in this room changed your mind. Only my presence, without doing anything. And so, it is possible to be confident in the measure, but typically not. And the goals? Oh, they are different. Any physicist has a personal goal which is different from the one of another physicist. So there is no general consensus. The theoretical physicists, for instance, are confident that the only interesting goal is the assessing the validity of a mathematical equation for accounting some data. A condensed matter theorist, they are not interested, not so much in sometimes in mathematical equation. They are interested in know whether there is some universality in some kind or in some class of phenomena. In social theory, equation is not so interesting. They're interesting only whether it's possible to assess whether there is some emergence, social emergence, of course. In computational neuroscientists, they are interested in brain behavior. And brain behavior is very complicated. The equation can be used, but typically they are unreliable, typically, because they are too complex. And the theories, this is a disaster, but it is possible to distinguish between two kinds of theories there, which commonly used. The one used typically by theoretical physicists, the hypothetical, deductive theories. And they are based on general principle, like the ancient philosophers. And from the general principles, it's possible to deduce all the consequences and all phenomena through mathematics, typically, which don't work. So in the modern cases, it don't work. But there are any kind of theories. For instance, in psychology, to quote a domain which I know very well, the theories are not theories in the usual sense. They are statistical theories of data, because there are so many data it cannot be understood and cannot be explained. And the only job is to use the statistics in order to build with the theories of the existing data. This is another problem. Then I will quote here very shortly, I hope, some problems, some only problems of actual theoretical physics, which induce to think that it is needed some change in physics. The first problem is the possible loss of Lorentz invariance, which Gianni mentioned before. And another is the inadequacy of particle concept in quantum field theory. What is particle? Exists a particle? And then it is used for the concept of particles. And another problem is the fact that quantum mechanics, which was the theory of atoms, molecules, particles, and so on, is useful to deal with the cognitive phenomena, which are typically macroscopic. Another is the existence of bottom-up and top-down causation, which is very different from traditional theoretical physics. Another is the terrible problem, never solved, is the intrinsic unpredictability of complex systems, because the world is based totally on complex systems. Are they predictable? Typically not. It is possible to study them? Yes, a little bit, yes. Only one part. If one knows a part, unknown the other part, in principle. Well, I shortly speaking about the possible loss of Lorentz invariance. Of course, the loss of locally of Lorentz invariance existed from many times. General relativity is predicts a loss of general of Lorentz invariance, except or apart from some particular special cases in which there is a real mean Cauchyan space. But generally, it's not the interesting case. So, I remarked that the general theory of relativity is very strange, because here on the left side we have a geometrical term. On the other hand, we have a term which is not geometrical on the right hand, and this term is not predicted in the original Einstein formulation, because it's copied practically from the special relativity. One is necessary to specify what is the Tmunu. Tmunu is extracted from the old knowledge about the traditional special relativity. Oh, this system works when we do with cosmology, for instance, but in other cases it is a problem. Another problem which I don't want here is that we use a term of proportionality constant, which is a constant. Ma it is a constant? Or maybe G and the other terms here could be dependent from the interaction? Could be the case. It's not forbidden. But this path has never been explored. So general relativity is a semi-theory in a sense, because there is a correct theory of this term, which is used in empty space, empty models. But the other term is a hypothesis only. Then, in any case, the loss of Lorentz invariance connected to general relativity theory is a global term, which is not so important. After all, the general theory of relativity is not compatible so far with the standard model. So most part of physicists ignore what happens here. So it is not interesting. Only the standard model is interesting. And so even the problem of general relativity are left to the one dealing with quantum gravity, which is a very small community. The loss of Lorentz invariance, interesting, is the one of local Lorentz invariance. Another conviction is that generally theoretical physicists use the Lorentz invariance. This is not always true. In some cases, they are not interested. Why? A number of physicists is convicted that traditional interactions don't exist. Traditional interactions are a dream of particle physicists, but the most part of the theory existing are busy, are effective field theories, nothing else. And maybe also the traditional interaction, maybe all a local effect, maybe. Then, in this case, to be worried about the local invariance, it's not so important. If I deal with a phenomenon on a normal scale, Lorentz invariance is not so important. And, in order to build the Lagrangian or a Victorian, one can use terms which are not Lorentz invariant. An example, in the case of fluids, fluids, the Lorentz invariance is not so important. Nobody takes care of Lorentz invariance. It's a larger jump of a superfluid, for instance. But there are many other examples. This is another example which is celebrated because it was introduced by Kostelecki. Kostelecki introduced a number of different theoretical models in which there is a violation of Lorentz invariance for different reasons. This one is only one case, the case of the electrodynamics model. In this model, we have an electromagnetic potential which violates Lorentz invariance, owing to the terms including the product of the potential with the field. And in this case, there are some coefficients ruling the effect. But this theory is only an example. The problem is to find a practical, empirical confirmation, which is not exists in this moment for the theory of Kostelecki. But this is not for speaking about the Kostelecki theory, but only for speaking about the fact that it is not difficult to introduce theories in which there is violation of Lorentz invariance in some way, in one or in another. I think that a list of possible theories, including Lorentz violation, is very, very, very high. It is clear that the most interesting example was quoted before by Gianni, is the deformed spatial relativity, which introduces a deformed space time. You have seen already this formula, one of the possible formulas, and what is interesting is the deformation of space time introduces automatically a loss of Lorentz invariance, not only, but depends on the energy of the process under consideration. I don't speak about this topic, but I must introduce some two remarks. The first remark is that the metric coefficient depend not only on the energy scale, but depending only on the kind of interaction, which is important. The second consideration is that in this way, even the deformation is small, it appears not so strong, but the geometric structure becomes very complicated only for this fact. And so it's equivalent to the introduction of some gauge field, and this field introduces not only curvature but torsion also, which complicates enormously the description. But the complication is based also, which is not quoted here, on the fact that all these phenomena are non-linear. This is the problem. Being non-linear, the entity of the energy, apart from the dependence, the entity is not so important, because in the non-linear field it is possible with very small energy or very small variation of energy or very small density of energy to introduce a big effect. Only for this, because the non-linearity is very powerful from this point of view. This is an aspect not always quoted, but it is very important. Of course, it is possible to exploit this fact in order to build some many other models, not only the ones quoted by Gianni, in order to build the geometrical models of unified field theories also. And this enterprise has to be still done. The inadequacy of particle concept in quantum field theory. I quote here a title of a famous article, a celebrated article by a physicist, philosopher. It's difficult to distinguish, because many physicists work like the philosopher. And the title is, what is quantum field theory? The quantum field theory don't include particles. Don't include fields. What includes? This is the problem. And there is no ontology. How to find an ontology for quantum field theory? Why? Well, the role of quantum field theory, which is important, conceptually important, not only because quantum field theory sometimes is used to derive some practical empirical result. This is one role, but not the principal role. The principal role is conceptual. As you know, at the end of the 19th century, there was the struggle between the physicist like Lorentz, convinced that all the world is based on particles and only on the source fields, nothing else. And the other point of view is the one held by Maxwell. And Maxwell had the so-called Maxwellian dream, in which there are only fields, not particles. What are particles? Oh, particles, they have concentrations. Concentrations of the fields in some particular domains, nothing else. The dream of Maxwell is based on the fact that fields can propagate without sources. And so, one has the normal electromagnetic fields, and normal electromagnetic fields, initially they need some source, but after the wave go directly. Then this dream was reinforced by general theory of relativity, because it's possible to have empty space-times without with metric, but without tensor, energy tensor, and there is a propagation of gravitational waves inside. So it is possible to imagine a world in which there were only fields, not particles. This struggle arrived up to the modern situation, and actually we can think that quantum field theory is the best representation of a world based only on fields and not on particles. But what is this representation? Huh. It was built in a terrible manner, and the goal was to help the particle physics, nothing else. And so these enterprises in so not finished actually. It is possible, it is very difficult to answer the question, what is a quantum field theory? Because there are many different answers. And in fact, the quantum field theory was tailored to fit the needs of the growing particle physics. In quantum field theory, there are creation and annihilation operators. Typically, this one is one of the possible representations of quantum field theory. There are other representations which not include creation and annihilation operators. But particle physicists want this formulation. This operator satisfies canonical commutation or if the case of fermionic fields and the commutation relation. If there is a suitable vacuum state, what is? This is the problem of this vacuum state, unsolved so far. In any case, also introduced a vacuum state, it is possible to use the creation operators, and the creation operator creates a particle, which it is a particle. But it is a field quantum, not a particle. The interpretation of particle is typical in standard of standard model, but there is no limitation. There is a real particle in the sense of being taken. In fact, there are many theories which forbid this interpretation. The first theory is the Rich-Hilbert theorem, which I have not known here in the mathematical description. It is impossible to count the number of field quanta within a bounded space-time region. Why? Because in quantum field theory, being a quantum field, act on the whole universe. And so every universe state is connected to any other physical possible state in the whole universe. And so how to count the number of quanta in a specific space-time region? Because there is not the concept of specific quantum time, quantum space-time region. And so, any space-time region is connected with another space-time region. So it's impossible to do a count of this kind. The Uhlu effect, very good, was the object of my PhD thesis. The Uhlu effect is terrible, because if we observe a quantum field, the possible total in the whole universe number of quanta depends on the representation we adopt. Changing representation, the total number of field quanta changes, and so it is possible to observe in some case a number of particles of quanta, and in other case the number changes in another representation. So the number is not fixed. Added, if we are interacting things, it is impossible even to introduce the concept itself of the total number of quanta cannot be defined in any way. It's not possible to count the particles. It's not possible to know whether they are in one region or in another region. What is the particle? The concept of particle don't exist in any way. And why the field quanta are interpreted as particles? There is no reason. It is possible to renounce to the concept of particles and works only with fields? No, it's not possible. It's also impossible. Why? Because in quantum field theory, the fields cannot be observed. They are some kind of potentialities. The potentialities are not actually realized, typically. The only knowledge which can be extracted from the formalism of quantum field theory is to find the correlation between the potentialities. The correlation can be used and are typically used for normal theories in order to build this matrix and other system in order to predict what happens probabilistically of the interaction between supposed existing elementary particles. But how to find an empirical content for the concept of field? Typically not in the original formalism, but it is possible to enter into the quantum field theory and to introduce some average operation, which is a statistical operation. Then the concept of particle can be maintained by using the statistical concept only, of course. It is interesting to do, I have not here, some numerical experiments. In this experiment, it is possible with very simple models, like kinks, for example, working with scalar models which are like particles in the kink, made in this way, it is possible to control whether the kink maintain their form like a particle. Typically, what is observed is that more or less they maintain, but not exactly. So the concept of particle changes a little bit, changes in the life of the possible particle. So can you be confident in this kind of particle? This is what is available. Nothing else is available in this moment. Why to use this is another strange fact. The effectiveness of quantum mechanics in studying and accounting for macroscopic and cognitive phenomena. And this is an example because regards the most interesting domain. The domain most often studied is the one of decision making. Decision making, it is possible to use the data in order to try to account for the existing data about decision making, or through classical theories or through quantum theories. Happily or unfortunately, the quantum theory is able to account the classical theory not. There is some quantum mechanism inside the brain, and there is some quantum mechanism in the mind. We don't know in this moment, but there are models of this kind already existing. And this quantum mechanism at this point, the question. So, some researchers invented an expression, the expression is quantum probability. What means the name? The name means that quantum probability is a theory tailored on quantum mechanics or traditional quantum mechanics, but only one point, on one point. The quantum probability models are models of stochastic processes. These stochastic processes have a time evolution. This time evolution is computed by using the quantum mechanical law. And so we obtain the evolution of probabilities. Not guess, of course. These traditional models. The problem with this model, there are many problems, but the main problem is to H. The Hamiltonian. How to find the Hamiltonian? Because in normal physics we do know very well how to find the Hamiltonian. Here it is a problem. In some cases the Hamiltonian, if we work for instance on suitable space, on suitable, suitable lattice for instance, is taken from the form of the lattice for instance. But this is really not correct. How to find the Hamiltonian for stochastic processes? This is a problem not yet unsolved. There are some solutions. There are some solutions. But they are not so easy. They are. In the accounting with data, I remarked that the Hamiltonian is not found by theoretical way. No, it's not started before. No. The one takes the data and try to find the form of the Hamiltonian which is well suited to data. This is not correct, but this is what happens. Another problem, not only the form of the Hamiltonian. In all quantum phenomena, there is a Planck constant. How to find the Planck constant? This is another problem. It is possible to solve this problem by remembering that in the past, when there were the attempts to reproduce quantum mechanics through this stochastic theory, there were some introduction of effective Planck constant. The effective Planck constant and it is based typically on the amount of noise which is present in the model. So it would be impossible to introduce values of this kind. But in the practice of quantum probability, most authors introduce one for Planck constant, one number. The number is exactly one. It's incorrect, this procedure. It is possible, I remark, to introduce the network made by units following the quantum probability rules, and these networks are quantum neural networks. Their study is very complicated. In any case, they can mimic in some way the behavior, discretized, of course, of quantum fields in some way. What is possible to represent even quantum computer in this way, discretized, of course, not few fields, of course. An example of a network model. This is a classical network model. Here we have the units and the topology is a toroidal topology, which is impossible to start from the bottom to arrive on the top and so without problem. These units are stochastic, typically, and the initial state are randomly chosen. What makes this network? Nothing. Evolves. Nothing else. There is no practical use. And the stochastic activation law is of this kind. There is a parameter called temperature and so on.
There's a pointer on the table if you want to use
it. Oh, yes, but I know. Yes, but I know it's so interesting with the base of the formula, which is brilliant in some way. An example of the EG. The EG produced by this model is typical. Similar to the human EEG, little bit similar. And this is a case of 900 euros, the threshold of each new two, the temperature is one, it is not so important, the parameter. In any case, disorder, noise, there is a possible to compute the autocorrelation of function, which is similar to the one of the human EEG, not so different. It is possible to find for the existence of periodic phenomena inside through the periodogram and the power spectrum, but there is no proof of the existence of periodic phenomena. There is some periodic phenomena, but noisy even. There is nothing of this kind. It is possible at this point to produce the same network, but the only difference being that the neurons are quantum neurons, not classical neurons, obeying the law of quantum probability, of course. The Hamiltonian, by heart. This is a tricky model. This is one. Not important to enter into the technical details. The only novelty is that the form of the lattice is the same. There is the interaction between the neighboring units, of course, nothing else. But the interaction is of this kind. If some signal arrives from the external neurons, which are activated, then the central neurons is activated. This is the only difference, nothing else. This is the DG. Similar to the previous, not exactly. It's noisy, but in some sense denser than the previous. In some sense, the conditions were the same, eh? The same neurons, the same threshold. This one is the Hamiltonian. The diagonal and the non-diagonal terms are the choice of the Hamiltonian, nothing else. The autocorrelation function is very different, however, not the previous. There is some ordered phenomenon inside. And this happens, is equivalent to the existence of long-range effect. The periodogram is very different. There is a clear indication of a periodic phenomenon inside. And the power spectrum shows the same effect, of course. So, I quote very shortly another interesting name. The existence of a bottom-up and top-down types of the causation. Is it interesting for particle physics? Not so much, because particle physics is based on one level, typically. So we don't speak about different levels of particles in ordinary search. But one we have systems which have two different levels, and it is common to think that the macroscopic level is based on what happens on microscopic level, which governs, which rules what happens at the macroscopic level. For instance, macroscopic temperature is based on the motion of molecules. And the microscopic mental phenomena or cognitive phenomena are based on the activation of the brain neurons. This is common in the world of neuroscience, for instance. But is it true? We don't know what it is. In recent times, it is possible to measure the existence of top-down effect. It is possible, yes, through statistical physics. in statistical physics have been introduced some means for evidencing the existence of the top-down causation. I remarked that the top-down causation already was existing in quantum field theory, because the quantum field theory, having a field which is diffused in the whole space-time, includes obviously a top-down effect. The typical top-down effect is the one occurring in spontaneous symmetry breaking. Spontaneous symmetry breaking, there is the presence of an Hamilton-Boltzmann boson, which help to ordering all the system after the existence of the occurring of the symmetry breaking. This is a clearly a top-down effect. But here, this effect is based on the complicated formalism of quantum field theory. No, I am interested only on the effect detected in time series. If I have time series of data, it is possible in time series to find evidence for top-down effect. It is possible in many ways, not only one, many, many different ways. I quote one way here, which is the transfer entropy. Yes, of course. I am very, very close to that. Which is this one, very complicated, not complicated practice, but it is possible to measure the top-down causation. Oh, of course, in the particles is not so important, but in many other systems it is impossible. I remark that what would happen if for happy case one day detects the elementary particles and based on other most elementary particles, then the difference of Dirichlet will be very important even for particle physics. The last is the intrinsic unpredictability of a complex system behavior, because this system is based on the emergence. What is emergence? A different, a complicated argument, a complex argument itself. This one is the emergence. The emergence depends on the observer. We need a different level of description. We have the emergence of new entities, of new levels, which were not present before. And so it depends of car, of course, of the structure. We change even, and the system reacts with the environment. So they change the environment, and they are not constant in some way. I don't enter into the theories of emergence, which is one of my job. And so it is impossible to account for these problems. Then, what happens of the winning of the theoretical complex? But no. Before finishing, I have a possible hope. The possible hope is that. What is the goal at the end? The goal is to gather information and so on, in order to be adapted with the external environment. But what are the tools? The tools are experiments, theories, and computer simulation. Nothing else. What are the best? They are not the best, because the experiments are a disaster, full of errors of any kind, unavailable, unreliable, difficult. The theories, worse, the situation is worse. Disaster. And the computer simulation, identical disaster, because there are so many errors existing in a computer simulation. What to do? Optimist. Then, a possible solution, yes. If, however, you observe an agreement between the computer simulation, the experiments, and the theories, then we can say there's some advance exists in some way. Little but we can base our previous knowledge on this new knowledge. Will change in the future, because it's possible. And so, the theoretical physics advanced in some way. In some way advanced. Thank you.
One question. What's your opinion? Is it possible to receive uncertain relation immediately from Lorentz transformation? I ask you it because I heard that it is impossible, but we did it, and this paper is one of the books of Richard.
Yes, it is possible. Of course, I am not sweeping you speaking of this. Of this argument, because the use of this uncertainty relation maybe is the solution for quantum probability calculus. It's one possible solution. Yes, I searched for this kind of possible solution. There are not only one, there are many different which depend on the statistical distribution, depends typically, and so in the past many searched on this problem. So the world is full of results of this kind. Strangely enough, the cognitive scientists don't take into account this problem. So they are unaware of the existence of these possibilities.
Brian?
I was interested to know the points of convergence between my approach and yours. All your general concepts, I agree with it. And then towards the end, you brought in emergence, which was implicit when I said, and top-down causation. Basically, you've been doing computations which developed these ideas, and the networks are getting fitting. Possibly also your toroidal networks, agreement with the circles that Alexei Gardner talks about. So, we have two bricks to drop up.
Yes. I keep one argument, one topic which was a possibility of showing it here. Some time ago, I studied a particular system, which is a neuron, only one, which inside the microtubules, inside a number of microtubules. And so, I included a correlation, no correlation, and in influence, in the sense that the microtubules with their activities can influence the neuron external potential, the electrical potential of the membrane potential of the neuron. And at the same sense, the activity of the microtubules, which are inside the neuron, are influenced by the global neuron membrane potential. And so I left the system. What happened? The inside system, the microtubule, were based on quantum probability calculus, were not classical. What happened is that there is a bottom influence. I measured an influence of microtubules on the neurons, on the whole neuron. And at the same time, the whole neuron was influenced the behavior of the single microtubules. I measured to the entropy, and there is an effect, which is very, very interesting. The effect was manifested in the fact that I left the neuron without external input. And without external input, the microtubule were able to exit the potential of the whole neuron without external input, input coming from outside. This is interesting. If this is true, it is possible to conjecture that in some way our mind, which influences the single neurons existing, can influence the neurons. At the same time, the neurons, through top-down causation, influence the microtubules. So it is possible to say that our mind can influence the single microtubules. It is possible. Not impossible, in principle.
Peter?
So, when you talk about the macroscopic quantum mechanics type arrangement, and you say there's a problem defining a Hamiltonian and then the Planck constant, There's only one problem, though, isn't there? Because you can just absorb the Planck constant of a Hamiltonian. So it's perfectly reasonable to define it as one.
The problem is...
So you've only got one problem.
See, yes. Yes. Typically not solved, actually. Actually, what is existing is what you say, you see here. Nothing else. The problem is that's not been solved.
But there's only one problem, not two.
Then Alex, you're next up.
Me? Okay. So, gas problem, all together. So, in a way, what Brian said about mind and matter mitigations in this point, and another, the interpretation, in the life, we have negative entropy. So, growing life, so this is the origin of, in some way, local violation of the normal physics, just life. So I think that we have to respect the evolution of everything.
Oh yes, the problem is that it is true, of course, it's a trivial issue. But what happens in the world of neuroscience is that the most part of neuroscientists don't want to acknowledge this fact. This is this is the problem. The scientific world don't want.
They have closed mind, they don't want to see the reality. That's the key point. They close eyes, they want to see the reality. That is it.
There is a reason.
Just stupid people.
There is a different goal.
They don't grow. They don't make evolution.
The goal is another goal.
Then we go down.
The goal, this goal is the power of medicine. This is the goal.
Yeah.
If you have a medicine which has a very high power, the power is based on the conviction that there is only a bottom-up effect which is based on drugs and similar. At the point that there is an economic reason, there is not scientific reason.
Yes.
Last question, don't be too loquacious, Alex.
This is a comment on your last thing about theories, experiments, and computer simulations. I published a result on statistical physics back in 1977. And it was about the percolation theory. I'm looking at what is called the infinite cluster.
Yes.
Now, the property couldn't be attacked experimentally, and the first person who did a computer simulation got his simulation completely wrong. So you can get run into problems there.
Yes.
It's currently the book, the result is the top result in Stadler's book on the subject, and it's accepted.
Yes.
But you can get false simulations.
Yes, but there are so many laws of agreement, and there are a problem. But there is an advance in the same way, because when we detect a loss of agreement, you must investigate the situation deeply, in a deeper way. And so this is an advance only to recognize that the situation is not the good situation.
But there's another kind of problem you can run into. You can develop a theory which requires such originality that most people are convinced that it's impossible.
Yes.
And then they will tell you that the theory is nonsense because it can't exist.
Yes, of course.
Thank you, Juliana. We're a little bit behind schedule.